Got in one, and it's not easy to get in it, but that at the time was a pretty significant step up from a Jet Provost.
Oh, yes.
I think the Tucano to Hawk step isn't quite so severe, would you agree or not?
I think now with the brand new Hawk T2 in service now, with number 4 squadron at Valley, that's also a bit of a jump.
We did get a call from Neil. He no doubt just got away from Andy Hill as he went behind the crowd there. And typical of Neil, we were chatting to him earlier on today. He's a great sport. And amazing that a medical technician, would you believe, in civilian life, is flying around in one of Her Majesty's ex-aircraft.
Well, you've got to have a hobby, haven't you?
As well, and with any luck we'll see him displaying that in the not too future, but this is just a fun job for him. And I had the pleasure of getting in his JP with him some a couple of years ago, and it was a bit like a trip down memory lane. Actually, I'd forgotten just how relatively close everything was to you, and that's what an ergonomic nightmare it is, with switches all over the place. Such was the genre of those aircraft developed in the 50s and early 60s. There was no real sensible planning. Believe it or not, working as an electronics medical technician in Newcastle on Tyne. He was supported by his family as well, running the Newcastle Jet Provost Group from Newcastle Airport. The group was formed in 1995, and now one of the longest running ex-military flying groups.
I remember in Pilot magazine, probably about 10 years ago, they ran a feature where they were talking to one of the Jet Provost groups, and they said that you could fly the Jet Provost, well, I can't remember which mark it was, for about £90 an hour. I imagine it's probably increased a little since then.
Oh, absolutely right, yes. Mind you, I suspect flying a Spitfire is still more expensive, to be honest, but we'll check the figures with those guys.
I think you're probably right, yeah.
Anyway, this aircraft was built in 1960. It's X-ray Mike 479 out there for the spotters, and was delivered to the Royal Air Force in the summer of 1961. It was one of the last aircraft to be upgraded, delivered to Linton on Ouse, and served with one FTS as aircraft number 54. We've just been discussing. So I think you can see from the manoeuvres that Neil is flying today, it's a relatively pleasant aircraft, it's quite gentle, quite serene, and in fact he reminded me that any private pilot with a PPO can fly it with as little as 5 hours training, which just goes how relatively simple it is. Of course, it's partly those costs we were talking about. At the time, it was an all-jet training route through the flying training pipeline, but of course now the Grob and the Tucano radically changing that. But making very, very little difference, and of course modern avionics also helping
with that ergonomic nightmare that I was discussing earlier on. Slightly slower pass now from Neil. A good chance to for him to take a look out at the crowd and top side position. The injection seats in this aircraft also actually quite hard, very upright. You benefit from again a slightly improved regime there in the Tucano.
Yes, it's still a fairly upright seating position, but maybe slightly more comfortable than the actual seating.
Yeah. Only describe it as a ergonomic nightmare. I'm still just a little bit jealous that you've managed to fly and I haven't.
Oh, right, okay, well there we are. I always thought it was a bit sluggish myself, but it was always surprising. I was forever getting bashed on there, telling me to catch up. But nowadays, 300 miles an hour is relatively slow, isn't it?
Yes, the modern jet, certainly the Hawks at Valley now, I think you're operating in the 500 knots, aren't you?
Yeah, very much so. Neil, really ably moved, lovely gracious manoeuvres, lovely wing overs, gentle barrel rolls. And coming in for a low pass now from the right-hand side. And I have to say, he's become a very, very accomplished display pilot over the years, and a great pleasure having him. One of life's great enthusiasts, and hugely committed to the air show circuit. I see him pulling off now to the left, but he's tightening it up on that turn, pulling a bit more G. I think he's opening up the throttle a bit as well. Yes, just flicking in now towards the crowd. Come on, boys and girls, big wave there. This is Neil McCarthy at the gate. Irritating whiny noise, I always think, described by many extreme pilots, of course, as fixed speed and variable noise. Not such an aircraft, but it was an excellent platform to train on. I think that was Neil there just telling us he's signing off with his final maneuver. This is in still such good condition. Of course, it's one of the lowest hours JPs around. So this is now Neil's final pass, sadly. So again, if you've got an opportunity to wave something, hats, coat, ice cream, whatever you have, mums and dads, teddy bears, this is Neil McCarthy, JP3. Thank you and well done. Great to see you here. Bye, Neil. Yes, and a big one as well. Just a we like that, didn't we?
That was a delightful display, and it's looking particularly fine in this gorgeous blue sky we've got this afternoon.
Now, you can go and debrief both of those sorties now with Kerbs, because, of course, Kerbs did train on the JP. I don't know if you knew that.
I think Kerbs did spend some time on the JP.